Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Savior here from Excuse the Script. Today we're going to discuss the extent to which income plays a part in students' SAT scores and what colleges might do about it. Let's skew it. Today's lesson is on residuals and residual plots. This is lesson 3.3, day one in our course sequence. So there are two big tests that you can take to get into college, the SAT or the ACT. But it turns out that some people argue that these tests are fundamentally unfair. They say that if you're from a wealthy background, you can afford resources like hiring a private tutor, getting a test prep course, and those things can boost your score relative to students who may not be able to afford those resources. But it turns out there might be ways that colleges can adjust for this. So in today's key analysis, we're going to look at how can college campuses compare scores using data between wealthy and low-income students. If you'd like to follow along, you can print up our guided notes at this URL. So first, in order to learn about this question, we need to first develop our skills in residuals and residual plots. Let's start with residuals. So residuals are, if you recall, the error or the vertical distance between a linear model's prediction and the actual data point. And here's the formula for the residual right here. What does this actually mean? Well, let's look at an example. So in an earlier lesson, we looked at this graph, which shows the percent of school days attended by some students and their score on the Algebra 1 exam at the end of the school year. And we can see here there's a strong positive linear relationship between the amount of school these students attended and how well they did on their exam. So the more they attended, the better they tended to do on the exam. We also saw that this relationship wasn't perfectly linear. If we use our least squares regression line and put a model to this data, there are some errors between what we predict for the students and what the students actually get. We call these errors residuals, and they're the distances, the vertical distances between the dots and our linear model. And in fact, in order to make our model, we had to take those residuals and square them, and we needed to fit the model in such a way that we minimize the area of those squared residuals. That's how we get our least squares regression line model in the first place. So let's look at these residuals a bit more in depth and talk about how we do calculate them exactly. So imagine that a new student comes to school, and as old school, his attendance has tended to be 80%. So we expect him to have the same attendance at our new school. If his attendance stays the same, what will be his predicted test score? Well, we know that attendance is on the x-axis, and so we're going to assume that he attends 80% of school. That's going to be his x value. We can plug that in to our least squares regression line equation. Plug it in for x. Once we do that, we can simplify and solve, and we get a predicted y value, a predicted score of 37.91 points. So our best prediction for the student is that he will score 37.91 points on his test. So now at the end of the year, the student actually takes the exam and they get 44 questions correct. We need to find and interpret the error of our model. So the student actually got 44 questions correct, which means that we underpredicted his score. Our model underpredicted what he actually got. There's a distance between what he actually earned on the test and what we predicted he would earn. And that distance is called the residual. So in order to find the residual, you use the simple formula, actual minus predicted, to find that distance there. So if you subtract those two numbers, we get a distance of 6.09. This means that the student scored 6.09 points above what we predicted for him. Now to interpret it, we can just kind of put that same sentence into nicer language. So the student's actual test score was 6.09 points, about 6 points higher than our model predicted for him. That is the meaning of that residual. Now note, because of the order of the subtraction here, we do actual minus predicted. If you get a positive residual value, that means that the actual data value is higher than the model's prediction. The data value is above the least squares regression line. If you get a negative residual value, that means the actual value is lower than the model's prediction. The data point is below the least squares regression line, meaning the predicted is above the actual. And so when we subtract them in this order, we get a negative residual. So now let's discuss residual plots, which is a way of visualizing these residuals in a new way. So we've been working a lot with scatter plots. This is a set of data with X and Y values. We plot them like this. We fit a least squares regression line, and this one happens to be a strong negative relationship. We can also use a residual plot after we fit our least squares regression line model. Here's how that works. So residual plot has the same x-axis as a scatter plot. It's just the x values in the data set. But one thing that's different is that it has a different y-axis. Instead of the y values of the actual data points, the residual plot has the residual values graphed on its y-axis. And so we're going to really be focusing in on the residuals rather than the y values of the data. So take a look at this first point. For this first point, it's an x value of 1. And we can see here the data is above our least squares regression line, meaning the data is above what we predict its y value to be. So there's a positive residual there. In fact, the data value is 4 units above what we predicted for it. It's a positive residual of about 4. So when we graph it on the residual plot, you can see here, it's an x value of 1, but instead of the y value, we're just gonna graph the residual value. The residual is positive 4, so we're gonna put this point at a positive residual of 4. And that's where it is on the y-axis for the residual plot. Then at x equals 2, we had 2 data points. One was just above the least squares regression line, and one was quite a bit below the least squares regression line. And so we have 2 residuals there. One is a positive residual at a value of 1, so I'm plotted at a y value of 1. And the other one was a negative residual because it's below the least squares regression line of -3.5. So I'm going to plot that negative residual and do it in the residual terms. So I can keep on doing this for the rest of the data in my scatter plot. And we can see here that I get a full residual plot where we zoom in on those residuals. We're taking a close look at the residuals from our scatter plot. And we can get rid of the residual lines, and that's what the final residual plot looks like. So note, this residual plot is centered at a residual value of 0, meaning there's a bunch of data points above that 0 line for the y-axis. There's a bunch of data points below that 0 line shooting out from the y-axis. There's no real clear pattern to them. It looks random. And these, it turns out, are all really good things. Why are those things good? Well, it means that we have a well-fit model. We've captured the trend. This was a negative linear trend in the data. And the only thing left, the only errors left, the only thing left is this random noise, meaning that the linear model properly captured the trend and there's only noise, random scatter that's left over in our residuals. So this is a good looking residual plot because it looks just so random. Now, take a look at this scatter plot. This also looks like a strong negative, maybe linear trend downwards. And so what I'm going to do is fit in least squares regression line model to this. I go ahead and fit it. Is this a good model fit for this data? Well, there might be something weird going on that you can already kind of pick up on, but to take a closer look, we can plot the residuals. So let's go ahead and do that. Uh-oh, this looks a bit strange, and we can see a clear pattern to the residuals. Specifically, the residual plot reveals a curved pattern where on the low x values, our data points tend to be below the least squares regression line negative residuals, then they tend to go above and then back down below the least squares regression line. There's a curve here that our model is not capturing. So our model is a bad fit for this data. There is a slight curvature in this data. There's a curved trend that our linear model is not capable of capturing. It didn't capture that curvature. And so there's some structure to my noise. That means there's something that I haven't modeled. There's a slight curvature I have not modeled. And so my linear model is not capable of providing a good fit for this data. So now that we've learned these tools, let's return to our key analysis for today. How can colleges compare scores between wealthy and low-income students? So one of the largest school systems for universities in the world is the University of California school system. And in 2020, they released a study of standardized tests and admissions at all their universities. And it gave the public a rare look at admissions data that's normally kept private. So I've compiled some of that data, and specifically this data is simulated data because the actual student level data is still private, but it matches the summary statistics presented in the report. And this is 1,000 simulated students who attended UC schools. Today we're going to focus on 2 different variables, the SAT score of the students studied, and at the time it was out of 2,400 points, the SAT, and the household income of those students while they were in high school. So let's get into our discussion question based on this data. So many argue that the SAT shouldn't be used at all in admissions, and here's why. When you graph that data, and you graph all 1,000 data points, you see a trend like this. We see a positive trend between family income and SAT score. As family incomes rise for applicants to the UC schools, their SAT scores tends to also be higher. So one worry that one might have is if you use the SAT in your admissions office, you're going to pass over the kids who couldn't afford tutors or test prep. You're going to specifically select students who are wealthier, who could have afforded those things, and you're going to miss out on some of the students who couldn't afford those things and therefore got a lower score, but still have a lot of potential to do well at your school. So here's a scatter plot for that data again, but here's also the residual plot, which might provide some useful information. And here's our discussion kind of prompt for today. To level the playing field, many colleges know about these kinds of trends, and what they do is they try to consider student backgrounds when evaluating their SAT scores. So one question I have for you is, how could a college use this data to consider income when evaluating their SAT scores, to kind of level things out by income when evaluating the SAT scores? And here's a hint, think about how they could use that residual plot. And once you come up with that, part B is the method you propose in that first part fair in your mind to both wealthy and low-income students? Explain your thinking. That's it for today's statisticians. We'll see you in class.